One big thing compared to the All-Stars is that we're back to 16-team lobby compared to the 18 here, Hot Jukes, which means everybody's kind of going back to the idea of how much room that they're going to have usually on those drop spots. We could see some hot drops, of course, but it's going to make those rotations a little bit easier for these teams to try and get used to and adjust.
100%. Well, let's see how adjusted they are. We're starting to see these teams lock up. One thing that's really advantageous for these squads, too, is the fact that we're back to a 16-team lobby. That's going to make this sand
right.
a lot nicer and a lot sweeter.
Definitely so. All right, let's get into it, Hot Jukes. Let's do it.
Here we go. Match number one of the PMWI main tournament, presented to you by Honor Magic 5 Pro. We can already see these players. They're dropping into the lobby, and always, every time we single we have the first tournament of the day, first game, I am looking to see if we were going to see any hot drops. Usually these teams have already done their homework.
Yeah.
They've already kind of done their handshakes before the match, because you really want to avoid those hot drops at all costs. It's just not worth it at this level. Even if you do beat that team, you're most likely going to lose a player or two, and that's going to make things that much harder for you.
That's for sure, that's for sure. I did wonder how they were going to remedy the STE tagline versus STE tagline. So we see SZSTE up at the top here for 628. And then meanwhile, we have Stalwart dropping in boot camp. So if you're keeping track of those two teams, we got you good to go.
Yes, you are indeed. And it looks like, you know, Gladiators are going to have a couple players nearby them. They do love that Camp Alpha mountainside range, so they're really hoping that first zone goes to them. But so far, so good. Doesn't look like we see any teams really getting too close to each other.
Yeah. Oh, and a mainland circle to get things going, as mainland as you can call the big island. But one slight change we've seen here, whilst we have this Paradise Resort going down, is that Gladiators had to move their drop spot a little bit, but I can talk about it in a moment.
Yep, well, yeah, we'll talk about that in just a second as we're watching GK go up against D+Kia in Paradise Resort. Ragnar up on the roof, gets one, looking to get another, but he's waiting for his teammates. He wants to be able to get a little bit more room. Yeah, he jumps off, says, you know what? I got one. I need the rest of my squad to help me out for the rest.
Especially smart because he saw a second head coming his way, right? Just over the lip of that building, so you do not want to be taking that 2v1 situation when two players could be trying to jump shot you.
Especially with an M16 in hand. If
yes,
he would have had
yes.
a DBS, maybe it was something different. But right now, with that M16, he's got to play things very carefully. D+Kia were able to get a full reset off. GK, unfortunately, do lose a player in the process, so they're going to be down a man here, and they're at a huge disadvantage.
Definitely so. And we've seen D+Kia be very strong when it came to kind of the long-stay engagements that would go down. But at the same time here, this is kind of really on their doorstep. They're going to have to change gears a little bit and eventually take this fight fast, because, I mean, it's faster than most of their engagements in the All-Stars.
This is what I think is the reason why D+Kia is such a threat. They are so patient. Even though they have the man advantage, they want another knock. They don't want to risk it. They say, okay, we know that we're up. Let's just take our time and slowly creep on GK, hopefully get another knock, and then it's going to be easy pickings from there.
Definitely so. Okay, if there's a lull in this for the moment, actually, no, I still can't talk about the Gladiator situation until this one is concluded. So we do have a QBZ in hand, and Hyde will be able to get Forrest straight away.
Forrest with getting knocked here is going to even the fight here. GK Forrest with the Sadan actually does go down. That makes things tough. But D+Kia with their teamwork working so well together. And now Ragnar versus Fabian. This is going to be a huge fight. I love the fact that he does go for those finishes, wants to eliminate all the information that they have, leaving Fabian completely blind.
Very important. Now it's 2v1 advantage. One's going to go for the res here, whilst the other one's trying to get out the angle, using that perspective to try and get that scan going on. QBZ is trying to go for that trade. Reinforcements coming along. Has to abandon the res. Will finish it off. And we see a full team wipe. If they can get them on their feet, that's a huge win for D+Kia.
Fabian with three eliminations to his name. And this is what I really like about this team is you could see right when one got low, they immediately backtracked, waited for their teammate to come and support them.
Yes, yes.
And it was just back and forth because even though they were really hard hit, they wanted to make sure they didn't lose one player.
Yeah, that was brilliant. Brilliant stuff. Really low, but great, great recovery there from D+Kia. Okay, so Rejects Tokyo, which is actually one of the teams we really need to talk about because of that Gladiators situation earlier. Gladiators, they dropped differently compared to what they normally do. They didn't drop anybody at Trifecta because they saw Rejects dropping there. They then rendezvoused together with two, pushed Trifecta, eliminated the member of Rejects that was there, and now they've had to rotate away. So a slight adaptation from Gladiators, but then they punished the people that were encroaching on their territory, which was very smart. And maybe that might ward off Reject Tokyo in future Sandhok games.
Absolutely. Gladiators want that northwestern island to themselves. So, you know, knocking out a player from Reject Tokyo, scaring them off, is going to help them out. They didn't get the zone this time, but, you know, setting yourself up for future matches is what kind of sets you up for a championship position, like mentioned earlier. So next zone, the first zone does go on up. It is going to be right in the center of mainland. Nothing too out of the normal. Gladiators, Vampire, DRS, all teams that need to push in.
Definitely, definitely. And with what you were saying about kind of setting yourself up for success later on, especially a location like Trifecta, which can become such an important anchor point for transitions between each of the islands. So yeah, they were very keen to make sure they said, hello, we are here, this is ours, please go away. But you can see them looting up, and they'll be coming a little bit later. But thankfully for them, with the circle the way it is, there is a great transition method still that available to them, like that North Bridge, for example.
And once, you know, it's such a high skill lobby. Honestly, it makes rotations out of circle even easier because you have so many teams that know where they need to be. The second that zone pops, they automatically leave those edges. They take those center positions. So those teams on the edge have a little bit more room to breathe as opposed to some of the earlier stages where some squads may be scared and linger on those edges for a little too long.
Yeah, you can compare it to day number one of the All-Stars, right? Where we saw a lot more edge play compared to confident center sends. But in a lobby like this, where again, I'm going to reiterate it, I think this is one of the most stacked lobbies of all time. I think that these guys will be happy to go center, happy to take those early compounds, happy to commit to them. And on Sandhok, sometimes the transitions are a bit difficult, but you know what? Sometimes you just got to gamble for it.
You know, I was talking to the coach from Alpha 7, and he was just elaborating just on that himself. How his team is so comfortable, and we've seen it before plenty of times, where Alpha 7 could have another squad pushing another and say, you know what, even though we can take them out right now, it may be better just to let them push and then we'll third party later.
True.
As opposed to a lot of other nervous teams that are just like, ah, see something, shoot at it.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
These teams, even though they're so close together, they know the big picture and they're comfortable being so close together.
I love hearing things like that because, as you say, trigger discipline in those moments can oftentimes lead to that team dislodging a problem for you elsewhere. So you kind of use the lobby against itself a little bit here, but we're going to get that shift coming in. Where are we going to go? Then we can get down to the nitty gritty of some of the terrain that we're going to end up in.
Oh, yes, we are. You can see these teams locked and loaded already, kind of placing their bets of where this next zone is going to go. We'll see where it is. I love this new zone system as it does go a little bit to that northwestern side. So we got a lot of water in play. That's going to make it a little bit more difficult as it does reduce the amount of spots available. But this is a very common circle. I mean, every player is going to know where they need to be.
Yeah, a few really important compounds between, I would say, Paradise Resort and Boot Camp, and then southeast of Boot Camp as well. We're going to see a lot of teams start rocking up to these compounds. That line down the middle between the two locations is very, very sought after. And look at that, good old Stalwart is going to be taking up residency in quite a few of these locations. Likewise, so is Reject Tokyo, though. They're already in an okay spot.
Well, you know, one thing I want to ask you here, Kalar, is first time us, you know, casting together a tournament of this size. You
We're
know,
a good time.
Why don't we go ahead and I would like to ask you a question of C. What are the advantages you think from a team starting off so strong in day number one?
I mean, looking at this lobby and how it plays out, when you're able to establish some decent dominance, when you're able to get center positions and show that you're not able to be pushed around, it does kind of ward teams from making big pushes against you. And unfortunately, Rejects is not one of those teams. They're losing people slowly. So, I mean, when you have this kind of dynamic going on, the opposite side of what you're asking, the teams start preying on you quickly. They see you as victims almost sometimes. So you got to be careful.
100%. And we've already can tell this is a huge LAN tournament here, guys. We don't really stress enough just how big nerves come into play. And if you start off, if you have those nerves coming into this and you start off with your players getting picked off little by little, it could definitely hurt you. So we'll have to see. You know, one thing I love to see from squads is teams that have that ability to bounce back, because that is the hardest thing to do at this level.
Yeah, it's going to play mind games with you. It gets into your head. And so far, I mean, it's only really Sara and one already down as well here from the distance. Twisted Minds, though, will have a knock themselves. Sara's back up and good to go. Well, actually, I was able to get his teammate up even, I should say, as Duelo's going to heal up here as well. But again, looking at where Reject is, they are scrappy at the moment, salvaging a situation where losing two early on is pretty deadly.
These shots are ridiculous. I mean, that guy barely peeked for a second. Instantly knocked out of there. Let's take a look at this little replay here as Lupa Monster. Player himself, just man, like we mentioned, we got dislodged by Gladiators, lost one player, and due to that spread out, now they just seem to be getting picked apart. With two players up, it's not going to be the start that they're looking for, but Reject Tokyo has plenty of skill in the bag. Hopefully we can see them bounce back.
What scares me as well for Reject Tokyo, whilst we're still on kind of the topic of them, is they've got Fireflux in on a hill where I've seen Fireflux win games from. When it comes to these kinds of circles, they're very familiar with this kind of lip, with this hill. They are kind of in the 2-2 split right now. But honestly, Rejects is very vulnerable to them eventually having a little bit of a peek over. Thankfully, there's quite a bit of tree coverage, but some of these players can see through those trees pretty well, man.
Oh, yes, indeed. You can see Duelo looking for any little pixel that is out of place. And you got to have that eyesight on point because there are going to be plenty of snakes in the grass. Here, still a ton of players are remaining, 15 teams, as GK is the only one to go out. Next zone about to pop.
And that's the important thing about 15 teams still alive that you're bringing up here. When the skill of the lobby gets higher, more people survive longer into the game. So
Absolutely.
There's less room to work with as the circle shifts hard east here. So again, as I said, Fireflux, man, that ridge that they like to play here, it's served them well in the past, and it could serve them well in this game too.
Now, I'll tell you what, edge play is going to be a lot harder than before.
Exactly.
Yeah, so a lot of those teams that depended on edge play early in earlier tournaments, they would see those weaker teams, those scared to be central squads, and just absolutely dominate them, get those eliminations up early, and then see what happens. But there are no weak teams in this lobby. Oh. Every single player here is an absolute beast. So even if you find a player on the edge of zone, you got to make sure you execute everything to perfection.
Okay, big rotations going on, but look at this. Compared to what we were seeing in All-Stars, honestly, you would have four teams eliminated by now or something like that. Everyone's playing it very patiently, very cautiously. They know what's on the line for every single game. 18 games actually doesn't end up adding up to that much, really, across the 3 days. And especially when it's the first one, really want momentum on your side. As Revo, going to shoot towards Box Gaming, as Box Formation may come into play, but they are going to be on the edge with that Box Formation.
Yeah, starting off strong is going to be so important. You ward off teams from dropping into your location. You make teams possibly even hesitate when they fight against you, when they realize it's you. So many advantages coming up for those teams. And of course, you know, those teams that don't start off strong, it's in the complete opposite direction. Gladiators, like we talked about earlier, they do have the advantage of playing on the All-Star stage. We heard Kitsune talk a little bit earlier how his team purchased these devices a little earlier on. He got the training for
it.
And he had that All-Star stage to get used to it as well. So this team is going to have a major advantage to the teams that are coming in here just today.
Yeah, they're coming into the circle, though, quite late. So let's see if they can make that work. Already a lot of these compounds have been taken up. A lot of good ridges in the middle been taken up. My question marks revolve around DRS. They're rotating far on the south. A spray goes in. Not going to be hitting anything, though, for Senate.
These are those kind of sprays that always give me a big question mark, because even if Alpha 7 does hit this knock, they're not pushing this.
They're going to pick him up straight away.
Yeah. So, you know, it's really risky. You're most likely going to lose a little bit of health, but he does hit a couple shots. So maybe possibly looking to eliminate their armor here going into this next circle.
DRS coming in from the south side of the circle by listening. Or they might go for... This is a huge wrap by DRS. It's bold, and I kind of like it. They're going to be coming in. Okay, no, they are
south
coming in precisely the south side. And that's not as wide as I thought it was going to be, so never mind.
Yeah. I mean, they did do a little bit of a wrap, but I mean, they did send it right here to the edge. This is going to be a tough one for them. You do see Senatex, I get one knock there onto D plus Kia. I believe that's going to be two. So with two knocks, if they're going to push, that's going to be the time to do it. But with how many teams are close by, it is so difficult to push these kinds of plays. Timing is everything. You push too soon, and you can get third party. You push too late, you can get third party. So next zone does come on up. And regardless, you got to move no matter what.
Already D plus Kia, been through the wars, as Infinity IQ is going to be pushing up against them. Sadan down once again. Actually, second knock for him. So you don't want to be getting knocked many more times here. It will be difficult to get someone up in that scenario if they do, but Infinity IQ knows that they must push this location and eventually quite aggressively.
Vampire going up against Twisted Minds. Here comes a big battle here, 4v4. Sweps does have those angles. He's gonna throw that nice jump nade. Ooh, gets beat up pretty bad, but he hits the nade onto Dami. That leaves one player up for Twisted Minds. We should see a full send here from Vampire.
Difficult to deal with this, as another nice nade was going their way. Didn't quite connect with as much as I thought it would, though. A bit of a push up. Two trying to push on this. Crypto not with too much opportunity here to get this going. He's sticking the res. This is very bold. He's now gonna have to remove, considering Ravenclaw was looking for the off angle.
DBS is out. Here we go, Ravenclaw. He's got the advantage. Nade does it, though. And that is Twisted Minds out early. And our All-Star Stage champion starting off strong.
Rough stuff for Twisted Minds. Box are going to be taking a fight against Alpha 7 down towards the bottom. It is going to get so crowded here, Hot Jukes, as now Box has found Kirio. He's going to go down. Senna is in the smoke with a DBS prone. He could be the snake in the grass they need.
Here he comes. Pops out. Gets one DBS shot. Gets another. Looking for the double play. The nade comes out, but he gets knocked in the process. So Box Gaming down two players, but Alpha 7 is hurt. Big time. I believe it's only one up. Yeah, that's going to be Rievo, the last one player up for him.
Trying to make something happen here, but it's very, very difficult. Even if they do, Box has already done a significant amount of damage here to be able to make this go.
I think if you're Rievo, you got to push here. Like, you just got to send it at this point. So I mean,
don't get the reses, etc.
Yeah, because your teammates are already going to be down and out, and the chances of you even surviving for placement points here in the Sandhawk is, like, practically zero.
Yeah, it's very difficult. Again, with the amount of people that are still alive here during all of this. Alpha 7 is gone, though. That's them down in 13th place. Here comes Vampire pushing on rejects. This is actually such a great opportunity for them because this team was already wounded. Dulo is going to go down. Sarah's charging a nade. Unless they group up massively, this isn't going to get much done. It's not bad. Where's it gone?
Does he hit it? He does! And Tony K's down to 1 HP. Sara, oh my gosh, catching another player. He catches Matic off guard. Another nade here. Good, he did. Oh, but his back gets shot, and he is out of there.
A lot of words about Rosemary. Pundits looking at him as a great player here to be able to knock it out of the park. Tony K, though, in the distance. There was a Molly on this rock, not actually catching him off. And then Smoke even blocking a little bit of vision, but three players here.
Rosemary completely out of utility, so he is stuck in a position. But here comes the rest of his team. Potato coming up close. You see he's got that nade locked in hand. Vampire on the back ropes, gonna have to hit some major shots, but they're actually getting helped out from all sides. That's gonna be Stalwart there with a huge off angle onto Alter Ego.
Makes it all the harder when teams survive this long and they will be taken out here on the push. Vampire shut down.
Oh man, center circle being so advantageous here. Stalwart holding it down, but look at this. This is 6-2-8 with the DPS getting the double knock onto Infinity IQ. Kaiju Law gonna have to make a play here from this tree. He has to watch his teammates go down, but you can see Falcon Esports in the back looking to clean this up.
Yep, you've got to take all these third-party opportunities whenever you can, but the problem with Sandhawk is sometimes you can even be fourth-partied, etc., with how many teams still alive, the terrain, the way it works on out here. Ferrari charging up that nade, going across the hill. He was hit as well by a nade. Punching King takes a bit of damage.
Sunan going and getting that secure. Very, very important for his team. He has three eliminations, so he is definitely starting things off 4-6-2-8. Meanwhile, you got Falcons on the edge of the circle. Papa Blue coming in hot. This is stage number 5. Blue zone hurts real bad.
Yes, it does. You got to be careful about this. Ferrari lying down prone. Actually sees Falcons members in the distance here. Look at that. You can see the pixels on the head, but he's not going to take the shots just yet. Yang actually knocks him from the other side of things to get things going. And trying to go for Punching King straight away will get him. Tries to go for the flush. Doesn't get the flush, though. But he was stolen, I think, from shots from Ketch.
Ketch, I mean, these players are picking up these steal elimination points like crazy. This team was on the thin side of the circle, so they had a little bit of time to be able to push in, but they're not going to be able to get a break at all. We're seeing teams drop like crazy. Meanwhile, Stalwart have the strongest position, and they are big chilling in the compound.
Look at that. Surprise, surprise. Oh, and the circle. I mean, honestly, Stalwart, they drop boot camp. They had the pick of the litter when it came to compounds, and they are not going to squander it here, as they're going to have a few teams trying to push up against them. And also, we're watching this go down here. 6-2-8 is having a bit of a rough time.
Oh, yes, they are. They're going to be forced to try and push into this next zone. Meanwhile, Falcon Esports are right there next to him. TQ with a huge off angle. Gonna go ahead and apply some pressure.
Coexisting. Meanwhile,
Yeah, they are coexisting for just a little bit, but they're going to have to start pushing into this next circle. There's only 15 seconds left on the clock.
No way they didn't check that Favian was there. That is actually quite dangerous.
Uh-oh.
You really need to cover these shacks because I don't really think he made that many noise cues either whilst the circle is going to be closing.
Steal.
Big spray from Six, able to hit it.
Taking up all those points he can get. Meanwhile, Stalwart refusing to give up this location, doing a great job of holding this down. That YOLO push. Oh, I thought we were going to see a little bit of shenanigans there from that nade.
This is actually quite dangerous for Stalwart because, of course, they were separated across this compound. This big push in by Tiamba could cause some problems, but they're holding well so far. They're also shooting at Gladiators from the opposite side. DBS coming in at hand here for Stalwart, trying to clear them out. They completely crush them. Stalwart doesn't even take a knock.
Bang! Four eliminations for Stalwart, and the best position in this zone is definitely their game to win. Meanwhile, we're seeing a lot of action here on the edge of the zone. Falcon Esports down to one player, but they do have seven eliminations. Alter Ego with two.
Nice.
Meanwhile, having seven as well. So that's going to definitely offset their finish here.
Man, Rosemary was just shooting everything, and he continues to do so. Kitsune in the distance will get absolutely obliterated from across the way. And that's quite the distance there across compounds. So Star Wars, we're in the circle again, but they're hearing these shots zing across them from side to side. They must be so content with this.
100%. They're looking for that chicken dinner, but you know, this is one of those dream zones that you get. You want to be able to get that chicken with a lot of eliminations, but these teams on the edge, like Alter Ego, with eight elims to the name right now,
they
are crushing it.
Honestly, at the same time, though, for Sandhawk, sometimes you're just content with getting the victory and a handful of elims here and there. It's the kind of game that you're like, well, thank God we didn't get caught on the edge of these zones with all of these other teams, right? As Ketch's actually pushed up for Fireflux, but I don't know if anybody's going to deal with Stalwart here.
Yeah, 6-8 was definitely one of those squads. Ooh. Meanwhile, Gladiators forced to push in the middle of that. Blow the play zone. Papa Blue taking down McHugh is going to make things pretty difficult. Tixie misses those shots. That is going to hurt. And Stalwart makes him pay for it.
They're going to get, they're going to destroy everybody on every angle here. Stalwart keeps escaping at low health. They just keep falling back to
cover.
They're taking the angles they need to. They're not over-aggressing on this. If the circle goes their way once again, they couldn't be more blessed.
And Gladiators knew the situation. They stayed in the blue zone, and they denied the points to Stalwart. In that scenario, that is the best thing that you could do.
I'm so impressed by Stalwart's ability to hold both sides of the road on this compound. They've been so good about it. At the same time, though, this could cause problems. Fireflux and them have been able to push up against this, so maybe this divide and conquer tactic might work.
Well, Potato is up close. Top is completely separated. They can take the advantage here with a 2v1, but now it's turned into a 1v1.
Oh.
Potato is going to get a finish. That is 9 eliminations. Huge game here for Alter Ego.
Massive, massive here, especially as I say on a Sandhawk, where usually it's all very spread out. The elims flying in thick and fast. As Fireflux here, they've turned their attention towards Alter Ego, trying to shut them down just in case they can only scrap for a second place.
Solus going down. Fireflux going to have to jump out that back window if they want to get the res. Meanwhile, Potato hard chilling in the building. Oh, and he does go down. So Solus getting picked underneath the building. Meanwhile, Fireflux, here comes Papa Blues. This is stage 9. It's going to go down to nothing. What a shot from Lutz.
What a shot here. Fireflux really contending and trying to push on against this, though. They're on fire, trying to get out of this situation. It's not going to be easy. Potato actually able to shut them down. He's able to scrap second place from this here. And Stalwart should be able to get the first.
Potato is hungry. He's got the Uzi.
No,
it's a 1v1.
No way.
Potato.
No way.
Looking to steal the chicken dinner from Stalwart with the jump shot. DBS, it's going to be a Stalwart Esports chicken dinner. That was way too close.
That was too close for comfort for Stalwart. They thought they had that in the bag for so long in this game. And yes, they do. But Alter Ego, man, what a play from Potato to be able to get that as close as it was.
I mean, their whole entire team to even get Potato to that stage.
Yes.
Stalwart had to do nothing. All they had to do was sit back and shoot at anything that moved at them. Alter Ego, they had a very difficult rotation into that zone, and they made it all the way to the end. That was nuts.
That is relatively difficult, very, very difficult,
yeah.
I'm going to say, on Sandhawk especially. To be playing the edge like that, to be down to two, to be able to kind of eke out each situation as it comes their way. Very impressed by Alter Ego, but Stalwart, man, they held this down in Stalwart fashion. They held it down like a fortress. They eliminated threats in kind of that 2-2 split across the road again, which is very impressive. Oftentimes, you have to get together on one side of the road to hold it down.
100%. Yeah, usually you have to go ahead and group up, focus on one team at a time, but they made that 2-2 split work for them. Absolute insanity here to start off our main stage tournament. It's exactly what I expected. Absolute insanity. Let's go ahead and take it on over to Jason Kaplan and the rest of the desk to see them break it down for us.
Well, break it down is something we definitely need to do here because that was a spicy way to start off the main tournament here at PMWI. Alter Ego, a fantastic push, as we saw by Potato. But Max, I mean, just throw it to Max. Just get him on camera. Get him a solo shot. He's happy.
I mean, a stalwart win, finally. This is the best start I could expect from the